Global growth is seen to slow further next year as colliding pressures from inflation, the impact of Russia's war, and sharply higher interest rates push the world to the brink of recession. Cutting its 2023 growth forecast, the International Monetary Fund warns the worst is yet to come. While it maintained its 3.2% growth estimate for this year, the IMF slashed next year's projection to 2.7%. That's down from July's 2.9% forecast. The IMF adds more than a third of the global economy is headed for contraction this year or next. And the three biggest economies, the U.S., Europe, and China, will all continue to stall.
And to put this number in perspective, back in April, when we made our set of forecasts, we had only about 5% of the world economy that was expected to have a contraction in 2022 or 2023. So it went from 5 to 30, so that's a very significant difference. And then we're also concerned about the downside risks. So there's about 10-15% that things could even get worse, you know, with growth below 1%. And 1% is a relevant marker, if you want, because this means global incomes would be stagnant per capita. And so that would be certainly a situation where there would be, the global economy would not be doing well at all.
As for the battle against inflation, the IMF says it has not been won by far.
Central banks have started removing monetary accommodation. They are getting closer to the point at which maybe we will enter into tightening territory, but not quite there yet. And so, in a sense, we haven't really yet have a complete picture that inflation is going to be brought under control. If we stop doing, if central banks sort of move away from the path they've announced, which is what we mean when we say stay the course, we're not saying that central banks should be, you know, stepping on the brakes even harder than what they're doing. We're saying, look, you've announced a path. We think that that path is valid.
While the outlook for global growth is grim, the forecast is a bit rosy for the Philippines. Speaking to ANC, IMF's Cheng Hoon Lim says the Philippines economy remains fundamentally sound as the global lender retains its 2022 and 2023 growth forecasts for the country in its latest outlook. The government targets a 6.5-7.5% GDP growth for this year and 6-8% growth for 2023-2025.
5% is still robust growth for the Philippines. So while the Philippines will be affected, it will not be affected too adversely compared to some other more vulnerable countries. It's prudent to bring debt down. But at the same time, they're also targeting spending on infrastructure, spending on education, spending on health. These are things that will increase the productive potential for the economy. These are the things that will create jobs and raise potential growth in the Philippines.
Lim adds the Philippine Central Bank has more room to hike rates to bring inflation under control.
The most important thing is also to get inflation under control in the Philippines. High inflation, as we know, hurts the poor and the vulnerable groups more than others because a higher share of their spending is on food, is on fuel, and those are the prices that have gone up. So the most important thing which the Banco Central is doing is to gradually raise interest rates and to get inflation under control. And similarly, we see on the fiscal policy side, fiscal policy is moving in line with monetary policy, and that's a good thing. Even with the recent hike in interest rates, it's now 4.25% accumulated for 225 basis points since May. Monetary policy is still accommodative. There's still some slack. There's still some slack in the labor market. So we think that there's still room for the central bank to raise interest rates to get inflation under control without hurting growth.
The Philippine government is confident the implementing rules and regulations for the SIM registration law will be released on time. Concerned agencies have 60 days from the effectivity of the law to formulate the IRR. An official of the Information and Communications Technology Department says their goal is to make the registration process as easy as possible.
We have already started yung basic legwork para po sa drafting ng IRR. It's more consultative lang po. Kasi kailangan po natin pag-usapan, meron po bang maximum number per user na pwede pong i-register? How do we make it easy for our OFWs? We want to make sure that the registration is also available electronically so that yung mga OFWs, hindi naman kailangan nilang umuwi.
There are over 160 million active SIM cards in the Philippines, 152 million of which are prepaid. Postpaid SIMs are already registered, so telco firms can simply turn over that data to the official registry. Former ICT chief Eliseo Rio believes, based on how telcos have been able to protect the personal data of postpaid SIM registrants, prepaid SIM registration should not be a problem.
Kailangan may postal address so that the bills will go to these addresses, no? Wala naman issue na so-called identity theft and things like that. The telcos have the necessary tools to address this problem.
China denying reports the Philippines has been placed on its tourism blacklist due to continued offshore gaming operations in the country. The Chinese embassy called those reports misinformation. It released a statement after Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri claimed Chinese Ambassador Wang Shilian shared such information during their Monday meeting. But Zubiri now says Wang's message may have been lost in translation.
I stand by my word that he mentioned that.
Yeah.
I never said anything about tourism nor blacklist.
Mm-mm.
And it was, so you can actually confirm this with Senator Gatchalian. The word blacklist did not come from us.
Mm.
The word blacklist came from the ambassador. And he went on to say that the Philippines had 2 million tourists pre-pandemic and that it would be a waste if they will go to another country. And
mm-mm.
basically he said, one of the reasons why that these areas where they proliferate FOGO is blacklisted is because, number one, they don't want their tourists to be embroiled into, I'd say, crimes with FOGO syndicates.
Mm-mm.
Because, they might be mistaken as FOGO workers and they're kidnapped. Number two, he mentioned that also there might be an influx of FOGO workers.
Mm-mm.
That is an illegal activity in China.
The pogo industry has been a hot topic in recent weeks, with some sectors pushing for its shutdown, citing criminal activities linked to its operations. Philippine Senator Win Gatchalian calls out the country's low conviction rate for pogo-related crimes. He says it's only at 1%. The senator also claims pogo-related crimes persisted even as their earnings dropped in the last 2 years. Gatchalian's remark comes as he renews his objection to allow POGOs to continue operating in the country.
Tuklasan rin namin sa loob ng 4 na taon, no, 99 na cases ang naimbestigahan ng police. Pero isa lang ang nakulong. Kaya malakas ang loob ng mga kriminal na konektado sa POGO kasi alam nila makakawala sila. So ang conviction rate ng mga pogo related crimes is only 1%. So napakababa.
The Philippine Justice Department meanwhile says the ramped up crackdown on illegal offshore gaming operators continues. It says government has already canceled the visas of 1,424 Chinese nationals working at unlicensed pogos. But that's still a far cry from the projected total of more than 48,000. The DOJ, meanwhile, says it will look into the appeal of some illegal POGO workers to be transferred to legal POGO companies.
Meron
meron po kaming na-receive po na report na may mga Chinese nationals na humingi ho ng tulong para makapag-transfer ho sila doon sa mga legal na POGO companies. So, yun po yung minaaral po natin sa Bureau of Immigration kung paano po yung magiging proseso noon. Dahil magagaling po sila sa mga illegal na POGO, pero ang gusto nila, pumasok doon sa mga legal. Kaya, yun, kailangan mo natin aralin yun. Ang policy na sinet ho ng DOJ sa start ay bumalik ho muna sila sa China bago sila bumalik dito at ma-employ doon sa mga legal na company.